One of the things that, as we talk about this, I mean, we're engaging with customers all the time. And I thought that it would be a good place to start is to think about, a lot of the challenges that these organizations are facing on a regular basis these days. They're really facing increasing threats, and they're doing this while the landscape is shifting underneath their feet. So in this example, we have a number of stats showing that 20% or 28% of these organizations are having to deal with some form of ransomware in the last year, as well as 34% of these organizations are reporting having malware in 2020. And so these are becoming commonplace threats that they're having to deal with all the time. And then if you think about the shifting landscape, businesses are already seeing long-term IT effects. 76% of businesses are expecting that COVID is going to dramatically impact their business for the long haul. And already 22% of the workforce is expected to remain fully remote through 2025. And so while all this is going on, organizations are trying to actually put forward their agendas. They're trying to enact digital transformation projects and work through and come up with more innovation, but they're doing so with limited resources and while still having to deal with all of these attacks. So 77% of CIOs were saying that digital transformation is their biggest budget priority for 2021. But yet you kind of have this disparity of only 16% claim that they have the skill set to actually deliver on their digital strategy. So there's a big challenge there, is showing that the desire is there, the need is there, and they want to, they have the money necessarily, but they don't necessarily always have the right resources at the right time to really act on it. And while this is going on, we're under constant attack. So, and 36% of data breaches use some form of phishing as a tactic. So always going after credentials, and 85% of all data breaches involve some human element. Last stats came from the Verizon data breach report. So you can see that this isn't just about technology, it's also about people and how do we build a culture of really implementing the right processes and tackling this in an effective way to help deal with this onslaught. So there really is this need for cyber resiliency. There's no way around it. If your organization is targeted, eventually it will be compromised. There isn't a method that can be 100% foolproof that can prevent these kinds of attacks. So the strategy here is really about how do you withstand the attack? How do you get back to business? How do you still deal with whatever the damage is quickly and get back to providing critical functions? So it's all about weathering the storm more than it is about trying to stop it entirely, right? And the resiliency must be built in. It can't be tacked on. The efforts must be put in place to first put in a process to help inhibit the success of attacks. So what can you do in advance? How can you be proactive to make sure that the amount of damage that an attack can do is minimized? Try to really restrict the blast radius of any given potential vector. Also, facilitate rapid response and recovery. So you want to slow down attacks. You want to be able to minimize the damage that they can do while also increasing the speed of your response, finding the attack quicker, and being able to put in response processes in place and also start to move forward with the recovery as quickly as possible. Also, this requires that if you can increase the cost and uncertainty for the adversary, meaning that if you can make it not worth their while by putting in enough blocks that it takes too much effort for them to proceed and get anything meaningful from the attack, then they'll move on, right? This is not all that different than from when you lock your door at night and turn on the light to make yourself less of a target for somebody trying to burgle your home, right? It's trying to put in enough of these safeguards, enough of these inhibitors that it makes you a less attractive target. And if at all possible, put in place some deterrence so that way they're not going to be interested in targeting you in the future. So these are some of the things around that resiliency that could really help bolster your security during these trying times. And part of this, with regard to cyber resilience, is this notion of zero trust. And so this zero trust is not a solution. It's not a product. It's really a process. It's a way of thinking and a way of approaching the problem that actually involves many, many elements and involves many products working in concert. And so, but it ties in very much with this view of how do you build in cyber resilience. Interestingly enough, we also found some interesting data around how customers view zero trust. So the next few slides are from this survey, the Aircom 2021 Zero Trust Market Dynamics Survey that Chase Cunningham conducted fairly recently. And he surveyed over 1,300 companies worldwide. And it's interesting to see the results of where their heads are at relative to zero trust. So in this particular stat, 68% strongly agree that zero trust is a necessary strategy for securing their business. So, and this is the strongly agree. If you added to the other stat of around roughly 20% that just agree, you have a very, very high score of organizations really taking zero trust seriously. This is another view of, for the time frame of what companies are doing with regard to their planning in moving to enable zero trust. So here you could see that this is imminent. This isn't like, I'm going to do this sometime down the road. They're looking to do this year. And you could see, many of them are trying to do it within the next few months, as well as over 80% really is trying to do it within the year. So this shows that there's an urgency there and that organizations are really looking to move on this, which means that there's lots of opportunities for us. This is not a latent need. This is not a project that they're just sort of thinking about and toying with. This is something that they're taking very seriously. Some of the top reasons for considering and implementing a zero trust strategy. So 52% feel that this zero trust approach is more proactive than traditional approaches, while 32%, almost 33%, feel that zero trust is the only way to combat sophisticated attacks. So as I was talking about earlier with regard to building in resiliency and what that takes, zero trust very much aligns with helping foster that notion of building resiliency into the environment. And this is probably my favorite stat from the survey. It's that they asked, in adopting zero trust, what's the first thing that must be addressed or improved? And so before you can really, do zero trust effectively, 42.9% said that you have to get your identity and access management house in order. So, and I think that's actually, that's a clear indication relative to some of the other, options that were available, right? And so this shows that when we talk about zero trust, it really is an identity conversation. Identity is very much front and center and is key to zero trust. I'm going to go for the next little bit just over kind of what zero trust means and how this is something that we relate to and that what we do with our products relative to zero trust. So again, as I mentioned earlier, zero trust is more of an approach. It's not a solution. It's not a product by itself. It's how you view security within your organization. And so the basic concept is just don't assume trust. you know, some of the things that have been in the past where this came from was that, you know, when we were existing in a more network security heavy kind of world, network security always viewed the, security challenge as everybody on the outside of my firewall is bad, everybody on the inside of my firewall is good. And we would harden a perimeter around the environment I'm trying to protect, really keeping an eye on everybody on the outside and putting controls and steps to prevent people from the outside from getting that kind of access, right? And while that's okay, I mean, it's not necessarily a bad approach, but it's not good enough especially when we're dealing with such an open world today, where both cloud computing and mobility have really changed the dynamic. A lot of our people, you know, our employees are working remotely. You know, a lot of times our partners need to have access and we need to be able to facilitate working with them. Our resources aren't in our data centers anymore. They're out in the cloud. And so changing the view of this, instead of thinking about it from a terms of location, it's really thinking about things in terms of who you are, recognizing who is trying to access and whether or not they should be able to access. So it's about maintaining strict controls at every point of access and focusing on the identity as being the differentiator here, not the location. That's not where you're coming from. It's who you are. And the other notion with that sort of network security model was that you probably heard this referred to before, is that you'd have a really, you know, strong perimeter, but a soft GUI center, right? Meaning that you weren't really checking anything past the firewall. Everything on the inside was wide open. And so you're essentially trusting that everybody on the inside is doing what they're supposed to be doing. And that's not a good place to be. You know, you can't make that kind of assumption. So you shouldn't trust anyone or anything by default. You should always check. We should always put in the right controls around access at every step along the way. And what that means is, you know, following the least privileged philosophy. That means that only granting access to what is needed, nothing more and nothing less. Okay, so when you need to do a job and you need to have access to this resource to perform your job, that's the kind of access that I'll grant, but I'm not going to give you additional access or entitlement just in case. There's no reason to do that. I want to minimize the footprint. Again, talking about when relating this back to cyber resiliency, right, is that I want to contain this view such that only you can only do so much. So if your account's compromised, there's only so much damage that can be done. Whereas if I'm very open with handing out permissions and entitlements, and I give too much, if somebody gets access to an administrative equivalent account, for example, well, now there's a big zone of damage that can be done if that account gets compromised. So keeping that minimal to just what you need, and if you don't need it anymore, revoke the access. If you need to come and get it again to perform a function, okay, we'll go through a process to reissue that entitlement. But again, time box it so that way it's only when you need it, right? That's kind of the thinking behind this view of least privilege. Also, this sort of implies the next thing too, which I was referring to, is breaking the environment down into smaller and smaller security zones. So again, you're trying to compartmentalize the environment such that if any one part is compromised, minimal damage can be done. Okay. And this also has the effect of slowing down the progress of an attack. If I have to, as an attacker, come in and I'm successful in compromising one account, but that one account really can't do anything, I'm sort of stuck. And I have to figure out what my next step is going to be. And while I'm trying to make those maneuverings to get further and further access and get deeper into the environment, it's taking me longer, which gives a greater opportunity for me to be detected and for the organization to do something about it before I can do anything severe. So that's the idea, is that, you know, trying to, you know, reduce the blast radius, make sure that minimal damage can be done at any given point, and that makes it a whole lot easier to recover. And then the other tenet to this is that you're really verifying identity at every step. That means from regardless of which security zone you're in, or if you're crossing security zones, that you are being evaluated and you are being verified at every step. Now, that might not be a direct challenge. It might, in some cases, it might be an additional authentication if something is required. If you're performing a privileged operation, we might ask for additional factors to verify your identity. But it could also be just, you know, ensuring and watching that your behavior is in line with the expected norms, that you're not doing something that you don't normally do. And if you are, then I'm going to increase my requirements for a greater level of assurance. So it's this whole view of understanding that I feel comfortable at the right level of assurance that I know who you are, so that way I can make a proper determination of what you can do. So this starts to break down into actual techniques and technologies that we can employ to implement a zero trust architecture. You know, as I mentioned earlier, this concept of least privilege. There's also the highlighting micro segmentation as well, being able to put different controls over each security zone, but also, you know, managing the controls in a distributed fashion. So that way you can have this something that you can control more centrally, but still have each of these each of these zones being managed such that one doesn't open the door for another. As I mentioned earlier, you know, about this view of multi-factor authentication, but this isn't just about people. This is also about processes and service accounts and applications and microservices. So we have to have the same level of authentication and authorization control for programmatic access. So having API control and monitoring is very important. And so, you know, how many different devices or APIs are trying to access resources is something that we have to take into account too. So it's not just about humans trying to gain access to sensitive resources. And then, of course, we have to be adaptive. We have to be able to dynamically respond to the current state, understand the current context, and be able to view that in the context of the past activity as well, understanding the history and understanding how well that may inform what's going on at this current point in time. So these are the sort of the key elements of what you would think of through a zero trust architecture. And what I want to go through next is really highlighting, you know, what we do for each of these.